Okay, so good afternoon, everybody. My name is Rahul, as he introduced. And today, we are going to be talking about reducing dead code ratio of Python projects. So let me first get started with defining what exactly is dead code, and then we can talk about the other things. So dead code is something which never lies into the control flow of Python programs. So if you have a program which has a variable which you write to, but you never save from, it is an example of dead code. So for example, you define a function named hello, and it does something, but you never actually use it into the control flow of your program. You never actually call the function. So it is an example of dead code, and it needs to be removed because of various reasons. Like, there are, suppose you have a newcomer coming onto your project. So it will be causing maintenance overhead. He will be there, he sees that you have a function which is never used. He will try to look on whether it's a class method overwritten or what exactly is this function doing over here. Syntactically unethical code. So if you have something which is written after the return statement in a function, it ain't going to be executed any time. So it is unreachable. So and hence it is dead. It does not lies into the control flow of your program. And similarly, if you have a condition, a statically typed boolean false, it won't get run and hence won't be in the control flow of your program. It is equivalent of not being over there and hence it is dead. So this program or this, nothing will ever actually get executed. So this is an example of dead code. Another category of unreachable code is the continue keyword in for loops. So if you write anything after the continue statement, it won't actually get executed and hence dead. So now you'll all be thinking, how exactly does dead code crawls into our source program? There are multiple reasons for the dead code to actually go into our source code. The first one and the most common one is refactoring. Let me define refactoring as changing the source code and design to do the exact same thing or to do the same thing. So talking in very conventional terms, so we have three functions. Let's say I have an example over there, if this projector allows me to project it. Okay, so actually the internet isn't working, so it wasn't anything. Like, we had three functions which are named A, B, and C, per se. And A did something, B did something, and C called both A and B. So what the next part was, anyone heard of Uncle Bob? Yes. So he actually would have killed me for doing this, A, B, and C. So Uncle Bob actually is enthusiastic about writing clean code. So Uncle Bob saw me and he shouted at the highest pitch, what the fuck have you written, and do something good. So I just thought that I have to do a mighty refactor. So what I did was, I actually renamed A to something and B to something, but during this process I realized that I can integrate both of this into the function B itself. And then I renamed that function to something, and then in the C function I renamed it actually, and called the function which was combined A and B. So now in the process, I actually forgot that I had A function written on the top of the files, just like in the Python libraries. They are like span of 10,000 lines, constants are defined at the top, we actually use them at the bottom. It's very humane to forget it. And it actually remains over there for some period of time, and if you are a person like me, tests are passing, the thing you are working on is done, git commit, everything done. So no more testing further. So that would actually get into this thing, refactoring and dead code induction. Second is programming errors. So if you are doing a long if-else ladder and you have something in an if-else condition, you think that it is going to be true sometime, but it is a statically typed false, per se. So you have a power increase function which is defined to always return false, and use it in an if statement, it is actually never going to run. So it is an example of programming error induction of dead code. Another thing is during debugging. So yeah, that's also a common reason. So consider a scenario where you have a long if else ladder. So, and no matter what happens, only one if else block is running every time. So what you did was, you try to break it. You try to say, okay, if I delete this block, what will happen next? So instead of deleting, what you do is you append and zero at the end. And again, it works, git commit, everything done. But it also actually induces dead code and zero. So during debugging, we can do a programming error which does induce dead code into our program. Misspellings, yes. Misspellings are also very common. We actually, as humans, so we have, say, very similar names. So we have a power increase function and increase power function. And we use them at the wrong place. So if we have power increase function and we actually use increase power instead of that, power increase would remain as dead code. It won't actually be called somewhere. So if we identify the cases of dead code, it would also help us in debugging the code. So that's also an application of vulture to debug programs. And third question, the important one, why remove dead code? I wanted to write Uncle Bob here, but it's quite similar, interchangeable. It ensures high level of code quality. Okay, so it will be covered. It shrinks program size, like although by a few kilobytes, but yeah, global warming, guys. Program size. Maintenance overhead. So if you have a newcomer heading to your project and he sees that you have a lot of functions defined but you never actually use them, it will confuse the guy. Why the hell are they here? Are you doing something overriding or something? Maintenance. And we have considered enough examples of bugs being introduced because of dead code. So now let us talk about vulture. What is vulture and how do we use it? So vulture actually is a command line tool developed by Gentrix Sipe. I did my Google Summer of Code project with this, so I might over talk. Please stop me. Okay. So what vulture does is it finds the cases of unused code in all the Python programs. It also has an API which we can use for programmatically checking for dead code. So for example, since Python is a very dynamic language, we don't always, vulture can often give false positives. Why? Because you might have seen like a constructor function. It isn't being explicitly called over somewhere. So vulture can report it as dead code. We already have a standard whitelist, which always whitelists a constructor function and other constructs. But there are some public class overriding. So if you need to, so for example, there are some classes where if you want certain utility to not be used, you have to actually make a function of the same name as this is defined in the superclass of it, and then you have to do just a pass over here so that this function cannot be used. So it would be identified as dead code by vulture, because technically it is dead, but you need it to be there. It doesn't contribute to the control flow of your program, but it has to be there for the logic part. So for those, we can use the API. The API can programmatically check for dead code. It's a simple Python library, and you can check for dead code. It returns a list, an array of items, and you can go on with all the properties are listed over there. You can custom filters. You can implement custom filters for them. Also, this is a very nice application of vulture. If you run vulture on both your library and test suite, you can find untested code. So, people argue that coverage module is actually better. Yes, it is better. It is made for that reason. But one thing which you can use vulture over coverage is you don't need to actually run your program over your various branches of your program. Coverage does the execution of your program. Vulture does it implicitly, so you don't need to run it. Reduces computation. So we have already discussed the false positives. The code which is called implicitly, it is a false positive by vulture. So how to use vulture? Vulture can be installed using pip. It's available on PyPy. It supports both Python 2 and 3, Python 2.6 to Python 3.7 dev. For like pip install vulture, that's it. And vulture. that's the whole process of actually running Vulture. Also, let us now discuss some additional arguments of how Vulture's utility can be increased. So there's an argument sort by size. So we received various requests from programmers around the world that we need to sort out our priorities. So one way to quantize priorities was by the number of lines or the span of the code. So if there is a class which is being rendered as unused, so maybe it spans over 100 lines. So that is your priority. You need to remove it first and then a variable which only spans one line. So we introduced this feature named as sort by size, which if you pass on this argument, the vulture will automatically sort your results according to the span or size of your dead code class. Another one is exclude. Yes, this is very important. So what exclude does is that you want some files to be not checked by Vulture, like setup.py. Setup.py contains static content, which is never actually used by our program, but by Python very implicitly. So we want to exclude that file. So we can just pass on this argument as --- exclude settings. And that would actually exclude all the files which follow this glob. Star settings star. So if there is a file named prod_settings, it would be excluded by default. And also, this presentation is available on GitHub. My GitHub handle is rj722, and the name of this presentation is reducing-dead-code. So you can go on and download the source code. I have provided examples over there. My laptop isn't working, so I can't show you live over here. The minimum confidence. What Vulture does is, with every result it shows, it also associates an amount of confidence with it. So those confidence values are based on what type of dead code it is. So if we are showing a result of unreachable code, we are 100% sure that would be on the Vulture side. So why do we need this thing, minimum confidence? So suppose a scenario where you have implemented automatic removal of dead code. So if you need to be sure that what you are removing is 100% dead, it isn't used by your system. So we have provided a method to gain like if 100% insurance of it being dead code. So for your API or for automatic removal, it is very necessary to have a confidence. Yeah, live demo, I can't do it right now because time doesn't permit me. Let me very briefly talk about false positives. Why do they occur? False positives, they generally occur because you have, suppose your program provides an API for a user class to handle. So those would be actually called by your user and not by a program itself. So they would be technically dead, but you need to be there. So they would be rendered as false positives by Vulture, but you need them to be there. So you can just whitelist them. Whitelisting is a neat way of providing, neglecting those cases of dead code. Vulture won't report them. We'll be discussing whitelist. Just a minute. Setup.py, config files, etc. Yeah, we have discussed this. Yeah, handling false positives. So what the Vulture does is, along with the Vulture standard library, you also get a class named as whitelist, and then you can superclass it for subclassing. So for example, you have this library and you have this function, hello, which does nothing but except for returning hello world, and you want to create a whitelist for this. So from vulture.whitelist.whitelistutils, you can import this class, whitelist. Whitelist is an abstract class which does absolutely nothing. So this is a class which is used for renaming your thing so to another object. So it can be reported as, it should not be reported as unused, because Vulture actually works on the concept of sets of used code and defined code, and those are mapped by the names of your programs. So if you have a similar name, so whitelist.hello, this name and this name, these are exactly same. So Vulture would consider them as the same object. So this would be whitelisted by default. I have used this function over here in this abstract class. So this would be rendered as used, and Vulture won't report it. So this is a way through which we can handle false positives in Vulture. Marking unused variables. Yes, sometimes like in a for loop, we need I for I in range, and that I we don't use generally. If we, so we can just use underscore for underscore in this, or if we need another variable which we don't use, but for example, for say to denote the version of our program, so we can just start it with an underscore and it would automatically be ignored by vulture. How does vulture work? I think we can skip this. Yeah, I just can read. Anybody knows about ASTs, abstract syntax trees? Okay, so abstract syntax trees are actually the object-oriented way of handling files. So your file is a first-class object. You can treat it as a first-class object, and then you have nodes connecting the different parts, different functions. Every function has a node, every variable has a node, everything has a node over there. So if a node is unreachable from the main node of your program, which actually gets into the control flow, which is the execution flow, you won't actually, you would get a separate tree. If you have a tree which is never connected to the main tree, so we just grab that tree which is not connected to the main tree, we traverse it, we make sets out of those, and we just minus those sets. Like, we have a set of all the defined variables and we have the set of all the used variables. Subtract them and you can get the unused variables. Okay. So what's going on in the vulture community right now? We are currently extending whitelists for popular projects and frameworks like Django, Flask. Pull requests are welcome. Okay, adding vulture to CI, that's a very important thing. So I've actually made an example thing here. rj72/example-vulture. So since vulture is a command line tool, you can add it to the shell script of your program. So if you have Travis, you can just, in the installation part, you can write pip install vulture and just simple commands like these according to your projects. And it will automatically show you if there is an untested code, because you are running this on your project and tests as well. So those guys are telling me to wind up quickly. So I'm going through the slides. A custom script for dead code. I think we can skip this. Yes, it's just this thing. Get unused code. You get all the item is in vulture, is an abstract class which gives you information to each and everything of dead code. You, that confidence, the line number, the column number, the name, and everything. You can define your filters over here. So if item dot confidence is greater than equal to 75 or anything you want, for item to be filtered upon, you can do it through this. An example is in the vulture bear of koala. You can go through this. Okay, so I actually first thought that we'll be discussing about koala, but I don't think the time permits me. So I'm gonna wind up. Thank you guys.
Questions, please, questions. Yeah.
Yes, question is concerned about the whitelist, especially for the false positive code. So suppose we have a various environment for Dave, QA, TR, and PR that is running using the various automated script by TeamCT or Octopus deployment, etc.
Yes.
How the vulture will support to it?
How vulture will do what?
Yes, how the vulture will support. Suppose I want to do some code, whitelist A into a Dave, but not in QA, but something in TR or PR. So there are different type of combinations that I want to do it.
So you can actually pass on to, is this thing in a cell, in a single file or in a single Python package? Okay, and different environments you're saying. So what you can do is, you can make a configuration file in different environments itself. So what you want to test in environment A. So you can have a whitelist file in environment A itself rather than the package where you would be using, and using the command line, you can explicitly tell the continuous integration test to look for this file, vulture, project, and then the name of the file. So it will take that whitelist file into account and not the other one, and the similar for another environment. Any other question?
Yes? Questions, please. Please yours, raise your hand from this side, anyone question?
Hi, so like vulture detects the dead code, right?
Yes.
So now what? So what do we do after we detect dead code? Because like in some projects, you have a lot of dead code. So does it like delete them automatically or?
No, it cannot delete dead code automatically because we have a lot of false positives. Python's very dynamic in nature. So we have many false positives,
okay.
But we can use Koala.
Okay.
So Koala has auto removal feature. If you are 100% sure that this code is dead, Koala will automatically remove it. It
okay.
will show you a patch whether you want to remove it, and you press 0 and it will remove it.
Does vulture work for JavaScript?
No.
Okay.
Python specific. Okay, use the mic please. Yeah.
So my question is related to whether we are introducing bugs by removing code. Let's say we said we want 100% confidence, but then is there a chance that our unit test will start failing after you remove, even when we have 100% confidence
actually,
set?
If you look into the source code of Vulture, we only provide 100% confidence in the cases of unreachable code, where there's code after return statements and code
okay.
after continue. So that is syntactically unethical, as I said. So that won't introduce.
Okay, so let's say we tone it down to 75%. Is there a way you can, I have an idea for you. Maybe you can integrate with some kind of a testing framework where also the test will be executed and it will suggest that XYZ number of tests will start failing if you remove this code, something like that. So making it more practical for using Vulture, that's what.
Yeah, that's great. You can actually open an issue on our GitHub repository.
Sure.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
Any other questions?
Last question, anyone? Okay.
Okay, thank you so much.